And welcome back. This is the RPG check. Okay, that's a better activation of power or whatever the hell it is. Before we head on to Noonfrost, I am going to read our adventure so far. We have this journalist biography. I think I knew about it but forgot. The Tale of Theras. You've never taken well to people telling you what to do. What began as a rebellious streak has developed into full-blown indignation for authority figures and power structures, and you've taken every opportunity along the way to express your dissenting opinions. This is kind of like a psychological profile on our character as well, I guess. Coming from Old Velia, you join the ranks of a rebel cause there, but few rebellions are fated to succeed, and your cause was crushed under the heel of your oppressor's boot, leaving you with little to fight for. The first thing you'd like to do upon reaching Gilded Vale is to find yourself some new friends. You fell ill traveling with a caravan bounded for Gilded Vale. Sorry, I feel like I'm gonna sneeze. The caravan master sent you off with one of his guides, Kalisha, in search of a remedy. While out searching for the remedy, you were ambushed and returned to your camp to find it slaughtered at the hands of angry locals. You dealt with them only to be nearly killed by a wind that threatened to shear your soul from your body. You escaped with Hiodan and Kalisha into an ancient ruin. You emerged from the ruin to find a strange ritual being performed at some kind of ancient machine. There was a man there who commanded others, and there was something oddly familiar about him. As he left, the machine began to spin, generating some kind of energy, and there was a blast that felt like windstorm you had encountered. The windstorm you encountered earlier. It turned the others who had been with him to ash, and neither Hiodan nor Kalisha survived. So sad about that. You were knocked unconscious by the blast, and when you came to, you felt odd. You were seeing things, hearing things. You departed the ruins, attempting to reach Gilded Vale on foot, where hopefully you would be able to find someone who could cure you. When you arrived in Gilded Vale, you found that the town was not the growing and prosperous settlement you have been told it was. Instead, you found a dying town at the mercy of a phenomenon called Widewind's Legacy, and received a cold welcome from the town magistrate. Your prospects of settling in Gilded Vale looked bleaker as it was, but they may have been totally dashed when the tolling bells of Radric's Hold announced that their master's child had not been born in good health. The magistrate advised you to rest at an inn. You helped an Adir wizard named Aeloth out of a scrape with the locals of Gilded Vale. He was understandably grateful to find company for the road. When you tried to sleep, it was restless, full of encroaching whispers, and you experienced a vivid nightmare. You saw an old dwarf woman hanging from a tree in the center of Gilded Vale. She said a single word, "Watcher." The magistrate confirmed that you would not be able to settle in Gilded Vale, nor even stay there for more than a few days. You have come all that way for nothing. You approached the hanged dwarf woman from your dreams and found that through some means you were able to converse with her. You learned that you are a watcher, perhaps as a result of your brush with death at the ruins, and that this has given you some kind of otherworldly vision, though the dwarf was able to tell you few details. She advised you to speak to an old watcher named Merwald, who is master of a keep in the area and might be able to help. In Gilded Vale you met Adair, a local farmer and follower of Aethas. His family's faith, and his brother's role in the Saints' War, had earned him the suspicion of the local authorities, so you decided to make your way out of town together. On the road through Magrin's Fork, you met a wild-eyed priest who called himself Durance. He recognized you instantly as a watcher and seemed convinced that you were meant to journey together and instruct one another. When you reached Cadnua, you met a Rortai scholar named Kanarua. He joined you in hopes of finding an ancient and sacred text buried beneath the keep. Still working on that. You arrived at Cadnua to find the place haunted by hostile spirits, its master's whereabouts unknown to the steward who watches over the keep. Merwald was in the dungeons of his own keep, hiding from spirits hallucinated by his own tortured mind. His soul was awakened to his past lives, and some irreconcilable conflict from long ago within him seems to have driven him mad. He cautioned you that you may share his condition as well as his fate. However, he did also suggest that there may be a way to undo your awakening. He told you to seek out the leaden key, the group you saw before at the ruins, and determined from them how to undo it. I forgot that they might hold the key for the key to that, get it? Marowold's body was taken over by a personality from one of his past lives, and you were forced to slay him. You searched his soul for valuable knowledge and caught a glimpse of a room deep below the key that may contain something of value. You journeyed to Radric's hold and slew the lord who had caused so much grief for Gaelid Vale. You began exploring the extensive dungeon beneath your keep. You came across the huntress Sagani at a crossroads in the wilderness. She journeyed from Nasatak in hopes of finding a reincarnated elder from her village. Impressed by your ability to see and track souls, she accepted your offer to travel together. In Defiance Bay, you found a temple to Wutica, the purported patron goddess of the Leaden Key, but it had burned down long ago. A spirit there suggested that there was also a section of the temple below ground. Certainly was. Palagina, a paladin from the Valian Republics, was impressed at your handling of an imprudent merchant and presented an opportunity to work together to serve your own interests as well as those of her dukes. You found your way into the Temple of Wutica from the catacombs beneath Defiance Bay. You slew the Leaden Key members congregated there and found several promising leads regarding their operations that you hoped might lead you to the man you saw at the ruins who started the machine and caused your awakening. Aeloth revealed that his soul is awakened and that he shares his consciousness with a crude yet spirited woman named Isselmere. I haven't heard much from her lately. I really like that plot twist. In Brackenberry Sanitarium, you found the man you were searching for. He had taken possession of the body of a patient there, and he seemed to be using it to ruin the career of a man who had once been one of the Deerwood's most prominent animancers, a man who had been working on a cure for Widewind's legacy. The man wasn't interested in helping you with your awakening, at least not voluntarily. He made a hasty exit from the sanitarium, sending his soul from body to body, and left you to clean up the mess. You were summoned by Lady Webb of Dunreed Row, who seemed to know something about who you were and what you'd done. You met Lady Webb in her chambers in Hadrit House. She seemed to know why you pursued the Leaden Key. She wanted to know why you pursued the Leaden Key and was able to tell you about the man you were looking for. Theus Ix Arcanon, a man who reincarnates with the perfect memory of his past lives and who orchestrates plots that take lifetimes to come to fruition. It's pretty impressive, huh? You found the district of Heritage Hill abandoned, overrun by rotting creatures, neither alive nor truly dead. With the help of an animancer named Aldhelm and an ancient language expert named Acantha, both of whom functioned despite their own deaths, you were able to learn that the machine atop the tower in Heritage Hill, Tyr Nuneth, has the ability to anchor souls to their bodies, causing those bodies to remain animated even in death. What was more, Acantha explained that there are other similar machines scattered throughout the Deerwood that function as relays, sending souls from one place to the next. You brought the machine on Tyr Nuneth to a halt, freeing the souls held captive by it. You shared a strange connection with a woman whom you instinctively think of as the grieving mother. She joined you in Deerfoot, but you haven't seen anyone else take notice of her since. Basically, because she's been hanging out at the Cad Nua the entire time. You met an Orland druid named Haravias in the woods. He said he was eventually bound for Twin Elms, but he was keen on exploring in the meantime and seemed eager for the safety of a group. Right, we gotta let him see his way around here. You finally learned that Idair's brother Woden fought for Red Saris in the Saints' War. After meeting Widewin himself, Idair came to realize he may never know why his brother chose to support Widewin. In the ruin of Cleoban Relag, you discovered more ashen bodies of members of the Leaden Key, apparently dead after an act of self-sacrifice that had somehow catalyzed the Ingwithin machine there. As a watcher, you were able to relive one of the agent's last moments, and from that it became clear that these machines play a role in Widewind's legacy. With everything you've seen, you were able to convince Lady Webb that the Leaden Key was behind Widewind's legacy, and that their plot involved animancers taking the blame for it. She advised you to seek out the Duke Eivor Wulfgrin, who is currently holding hearings at a palace in the future of animancy. She thought he would listen to your case, provided you were able to secure an invite to the hearings. You were able to convince the Crucible Knights to allow you to join their delegation in the animancy hearings. At the animancy hearings, you made a case against the Leaden Key and also convinced the Duke that animancy was too valuable to be banned. Before Duke Eivor had even so much as finished the proclamation, however, Theas possessed the body of an animancer and assassinated the Duke, sending all of Defiance Bay into a frenzy. Excuse me. You followed Theas's trail to Dunreed Row, where you found all its ciphers murdered, including Lady Webb. But in examining the last moments of her life through her soul, you were able to learn that Theas was headed next for Twin Elms. Aeloth convinced of being a member of the Leaden Key, but claimed that, after learning of the crimes the organization had perpetuated throughout the Deerwood, he wanted to help you stop them. I said Aeloth, right? You agreed to let him continue with you. Blank space. In Twin Elms, you found that most districts were closed to outsiders, but were able to persuade the Anna Memphath to allow you inside at great risk to her own position in the Framascanxualas. Pelagina changed the terms of the Duke's agreement to prevent the Republics from stealing the Glanfathan's trade with the Deerwood. Now these visions we've been seeing... You have seen visions of another time and place. You were walking in a grand chamber toward a giant machine and a man standing in front of it. You wanted to ask him something, but what it wasn't clear. But what it was wasn't clear. You later saw the man from your vision again, a projection of a past life, according to Meyerwald. The man spoke to you as though you were a young missionary. You told him you had spent much of your recent life in a city called Cretum, and explained why you had come to join his order. Then he asked you to take an oath. A third vision of the man you've been searching for seemed to come at some time after the last one you saw. You were attempting to leave the missionary order. You explained to him that you felt responsible for a hostile encounter with heathens that left other missionaries gravely injured. Despite your feelings, the man persuaded you not to leave and lifted a great burden from you in the process. In the aftermath of the assassination of the Duke, Thea said something to you that triggered a memory from your past life. You saw a woman being tortured, stretched across the surface of an iron wheel. Theas was there, asking if she desired mercy, but she defied him. In the wilderness, you encountered a vision of Theas. He wanted to know how you knew a heretic woman who, like you, is from Cretum. You assumed that the heretic had been your mentor. Well, I'm just speaking of assumption. And that was over in Elmshore that we that I encountered.
No
him.
Problem.
All right, let's go to Noonfrost. Ooh, we leveled up. I found Noonfrost. Glamfellen have clearly established a presence here. If they're responsible for Alwa's disappearance, I doubt they'll admit as much. Still, I may be able to track her down on my own. Oh, Horarius is done already. That's quick. Who leveled? Pelagina and Theas. Well, What do you say, more athletics? Greater lay on hands. Ooh. Fuel is sold by belief the paladin is able to heal with the touch of his or her hands, recovering a substantial amount of endurance for the paladin or an ally within range, which is 49 and a half endurance over just under 6 seconds. 2 per encounter, yep, like before. Range 3 meters, I don't know if that's any different. Critical focus. Allies notice the paladin's zeal and become thoroughly inspired by it. Allies affected by zealous focus convert 5% of what would have been ordinary hits to critical hits. 5% of hits converted to crits. That's only 5%, you know? Deep faith. The intensity of the paladin's faith deepens, granting them increased defensive bonuses to faith and conviction. Okay, plus 2 to deflection, plus 5 to fortitude, reflex, and will. Passive. I say greater lay on hands, actually. Once a dare can level up.
Hey.
Really close. I'll try to get this. Figure this crap out. Realized last time that I have weapon specialization in knight, which includes sword, but I have weapon focus in ruffian, which includes the stiletto I've been using until now, but I just gave him a sword. This cat's claw. So it's a little slower than the stiletto, but the damage is much higher. So I'll see if I can do that. So she can level up. DS, that is. Survival. And, level 5 powers. Is this new? Borrowed instinct. Ransacks an enemy's intellect and perception for energy, causing damage to those enemy attributes while boosting the cipher's defenses and accuracy. Okay, so target is minus 8 intellect and perception. Will save. And Theodos gets plus 20 melee accuracy, 20 on everything, ranged accuracy, deflection, fortitude, reflex, will for 20 seconds. That's pretty good. I mean, how long do most battles last? Do they not even last 20 seconds? I'm not even sure. Tactical meld. Connects the mind of the cipher with an ally to gain the ally's knowledge of his or her enemy, bestowing an attack bonus upon the cipher towards the enemy the ally is attacking. Alright, so plus 20 accuracy when attacking the same enemy as the target. I'm gonna take this borrowed instinct. Hold on a second, guys. Sorry about that. Okay, so we can get another talent. Psychic Backlash. Invokes retaliatory strike, stunning an enemy whenever they target the cipher's will defense. I've passed that by before. I mean, it's pretty specific. Yeah, I'm not sure. Do we have anything like... I think we already have greater focus, right? What's that? No freeze damage and damage reduction? This would be great for Aloth to take, actually. Plus 20% burn damage with his spells, right? This is how you get more slots. Plus 5 deflection. This is pretty good. We get hit by that stuff a lot. And that. This sometimes. Offensive. Sorry I'm taking so long here, guys. Grazes converted to hits. Damage against specific types. Interruption. Vulnerable attack. Penetrating shot. Bloody slaughter. Attacks enemies with low endurance. I'm gonna just take this, one-handed style. Hard to decide this stuff, sometimes. Alright, so we've got Fog of War, which tells me sneaking.
Time to see and not be seen.
We're already 23 minutes in and we haven't done hardly anything. Hello. How are you this fine day? Vesicle. The pale elf searches you with ice blue eyes. She shifts and knits her fingers together. Welcome to Noonfrost. Most of the temple is currently closed for sacred ceremonies to Rimmergand. She forces a smile and waves to the eastern doorway. The shrine is to your right, where you're welcome to make your offerings to Rimmergand there, but the rest of the temple is off limits. Why is most of the temple closed? As I said, we're in the middle of sacred ceremonies. She enunciates carefully. They're rather complex, and we don't permit outsiders to witness them. She glances at the elves over her shoulder. Others of my clan get rather touchy about them, which is why you should visit the shrine and take your leave. Kanna says, "That's a pity. I was hoping to learn more about these practices. The more complicated, the better, I say." Vesicle's eyes dart between the two doors on either side of the room. If that's all? Tell me about Rimmergand. He's the god of cold, entropy, and collapse. Many see him as a harsh god, but few recognize that he also gives life in his own way. All things wind to a merciful end in his shadow, only to feed creation elsewhere. She frowns, gnawing her lip. But he is a silent god, and his ways are mysterious. To follow him is to accept inevitability without explanation. What are you doing here? It's an odd question. My clan journeyed from the White That Wends to pay homage to Rimmergand here in Noonfrost. We learned that this place has been abandoned for several years, and we felt it our duty to tend to one of the god's oldest temples. She rolls her shoulders back. It has been a long journey, but Rimmergan demands endurance. No doubt he will reward us for ours. It seems the cold has spread from Noonfrost. She stiffens. Rimmergan is the god of winter. It's been many years since his temple was attended, so there's nothing strange about a little chill around the place now. She lowers her head. If it bothers you, then perhaps you should go. Not yet. Thank you, though. There's some elves over there. What's with the fog of war, Veskel? The outline of an Auroch's skull is etched into this paladin's armor. This pale elf stands motionless, but for the slow rise and fall of his chest. Life is but a test of endurance. Its reward is to be scattered and reforged into something new. We pass through the White Marsh on our journey here, a pleasant, temperate place. Yes, we'll be exploring that one. Eventually. You again? There's nothing else to see here. The inner halls are closed. The paladin watches you with cool, patient eyes. There's no way we can take that. I just want to see what's in there. Is this where we can't go beyond? Like, we can't go that way or that way? I'm gonna go that way. The priest shows no sign of discomfort despite the biting cold.
I shall be quiet as a calm sea.
Shall we sneak
in there?
Which is
not very quiet.
We gotta look for this girl. He's following us. Maybe this area is okay. Oh, I guess it's just past here that we cannot go. You can see his breath. That's pretty cool. Ooh, you hear
what?
That? I heard that. A potion of iron skin. People screaming? What are people screaming?
Bye.
Yeah?
We kinda have to go in there. Or in somewhere. The pages of this tome glisten under a thick layer of frost. Yeah, it's freaking cold in here, man. Turn on the heat. Turn on the heat. Life is but a test of endurance. Its reward is to be scattered and reforged into something new. We've read that before. Her eyes are closed and her lips form a silent prayer. All things collapse eventually, even a place like this. Come to worship the god of winter? Not really. One day even the stones of Noonfrost will crumble into dust. This is Rimmergan's way. What's going on with you, girl? The white that wins is a harsh land, but ideal for contemplating the unremitting splendor of Rimmergand. We've come from the white that wins to worship the beast of winter. You people and your names. I just want to see what's in here. Ooh. I don't think we can ever take that. Hold, wanderer! Venturing beyond all doors is forbidden. Do not trespass against our will. Hey. We passed through the White March on our journey here. A pleasant, temperate place, I guess, compared to here. Our God rewards perseverance through hardship. Yeah, we're getting a hardship getting around anywhere in here. Oh, hello. A door just opened. And closed. Did these people leave? Well, we can follow them. Who's this? Oh. Each line and wrinkle of this warrior's weather-beaten frown has been chiseled from the ice. I hear them coming and going over there. Any secrets?
Eyes open.
I can do that. That's settled.
Cool. An opal, a pearl, and a blue crystal key to one of these doors. This key, its handle carved in the semblance of an auroch's head, was cut from a light blue crystal. It's ours. I'm waiting for this thing to come alive and attack us. You took the key! Now die. They're not gonna be happy with us. We're gonna break through their place. Hey, cutie, let us in. The true fate of all things is to be scattered like snowflakes in a blizzard. Never mind, then. Should I look for secrets?
Hello? Hello?
Reveal your secrets. The water of this well has frozen solid, trapping small fish from the lake underneath the temple. Like, what are these fools doing? Refracted light dapples the icy mirror behind this statue. People are not going to be happy with us. We have a quest to undertake. Can I ask this person about that? Did we not explore here all the way? No farther! Turn back and do not cross any doors. The halls beyond us belong to Rimmergand and his faithful. The paladin watches you with cool, patient eyes. Oh, that just leads there. Is that... Wait. That door's open now, isn't it? Not pause. Speed up. We're cold, man. Let us in. What door is opening and closing?
Lay low.
Stay tuned for next episode, guys, when we try to go through this door and see what happens. Thanks so much for watching. Endure. In enduring, grow strong.